groundwork field crews, but they have also quite a bit of responsibility, and depending on how good they are at their job, you know, they can actually almost act like a biologist in a lot of ways. But really, the field work equipment, just a lot of on the ground kind of work. And of course, there's interns and summer students. What would we do with either of those? I guess maybe we should have left them up together, because as interns are graduates, just as a position, you can get experience, and I'll tell you how to get that in the future. Summer students, of course, for the federal government, it's AFS. Your qualifications, managers range from BSCs up to PhDs for the higher level positions. Research scientists, you must have a PhD, except in those very rare cases. If you've been a biologist and you've acted like a research scientist for 10, 15 years, you can actually petition to become a res. And that has happened. Sometimes it might actually come with a decrease in salary. But you get the title. biologists, these days, you really do need an MSc if you want to be a biologist and DFO in the government, because, I mean, if we actually put out a full-time biologist position now, we would get up to PhDs applying for that. So, it's pretty hard to actually, you can with a BSc, but I would really recommend to get an MSc and you have a greater chance. Technician, BSc, or relevant diploma. And actually, in some cases, we find college students can do even better on interviews than a biologist because they have a lot more practical experience. And depending on the interview, the questions could relate a lot more to practicalities. Intern, again, BSc or relevant diploma, similar to an EG position. And there are a number of those, and I'll tell you how to find those in this slide or two. And summer student, officially you are supposed to be attending a university or college in a relevant program and going back next year. The going back next year part, we ask, so you're thinking about graduate work, and if they say yeah, that qualifies. But now our human resources people are starting to say that we have to actually demonstrate that they're enrolled next semester, and we're like, no, we won't do that. So I'm not sure how flexible we can be on that one anymore. Actually, before I go into the future of the job market, just a couple tips on the interview process. In all of the federal government, it's basically the same. It follows some pretty strict rules. And when you look for a job that's advertised and it has a statement of qualifications, I am absolutely required to test you all. Every single aspect is in that statement of qualifications. So if it says knowledge of, you know, fisheries, benthos, and fluvial geomorphologies, be broad. Each one of those commas means that there's three aspects in that one line that I must test you on and demonstrate that I've tested you on, and that you have knowledge of all those three areas. And I have to have a detailed scoring system in terms of what that answer means so that the human resources person who knows nothing about this can actually look at your answers and understand how I gave you that score. And if you don't give me the details, I can't give you a good score. So read the statement of qualifications, study what's in that, and give a lot of detail in your answer because that's where you get the points. And really what we're supposed to do is, it's a little bit more flexible now, but it used to be really strictly points. The person who got the most points was offered the job first. Now there's a little bit more flexibility if we say, well, they meet this criteria or another criteria. There's slight flexibility there, but points still is it. So don't be shy in giving details in your answers. So the job market, the government is old, a lot of general people who have knowledge in these general science areas, and they will test all these people across Canada. And then if you make the eligibility list, if I then all of a sudden have an FTE res position that I want to fill, I'm supposed to go to that eligibility list first and say, okay, this person meets my qualifications, they've already passed the interview, and I can basically just hire that person. So you need to get into these national competitions, because even if I say later, oh gee, you know, I'm hiring a bio, if you want it, it's not always going to work that way. Term positions, those are temporary positions based on usually soft money. Sometimes they can flip into full-time equivalent positions, not always, but it's a really good way to get your foot in the door, because once you're actually qualified and you get in a term position, even if it says it's only for 1 year, you are there after that in the government, start earning time towards your pension, and you start gaining all of these things. But the biggest bonus is that you can actually apply for internal only posted jobs. And so right now you guys are outside of the government, you can only go to the external jobs, but there's all kinds of jobs that are up there all the time that are only open to people in the government already. If you're turning, you get one of those, so it's always good to go for it. Casual positions, kind of one of the only ways we can hire temporary people, limited to 90 days in the calendar year. I could just say, I want you, and I put your name down and hire you. And that's why they put really strict limits on how long. Intern positions are usually now 6 month duration for the Y interns. That we usually get, I think every year I've been in the zoo, we've had one or two of those, and they get some good experience. Students are summer only, but this year, for example, we hired 5, so there's lots. Basically, I guess I'm not supposed to ask the questions yet. I guess this slide will be on your site, and those websites will be available for you to write down. And that's where you find